I think it is entirely fair to say that Elmer Bernstein is the eighth member of the cast of The Magnificent Seven. The music is so important in this film. It's crucial. It's more vital, I think, in this film than in many Westerns of the time. When Elmer Bernstein scored The Magnificent Seven in 1960, he'd been in Hollywood for about 10 years, scoring movies like The Man with the Golden Arm and The Ten Commandments. He's now the longest-working active composer in Hollywood, having written scores for over 50 years. He's done over 150 films, but it was really the score for The Magnificent Seven that established him as a real force on the scene of Western movies. Bernstein came from a classical background. His mentor, in fact, was Aaron Copland, who many people consider the father of American 20th century music. And you can hear that in portions of the Magnificent Seven score. There's a great Americana feel in terms of the melodies and the harmonies, especially in the main theme. From the very first frames, Bernstein's score, with those thrilling opening chords, sets you on course. That opening sequence, which gives you that expansive main theme with those exciting driving rhythms, establishes that you're going to see an exciting Western picture. The main theme occurs at very specific moments throughout the picture. We don't hear it often, but when we do hear it, it really makes a statement. And it occupies almost 2 minutes while the credits roll. Then immediately afterwards, we're plunged into the action as Calvera's gang rides into the town, and you hear the bad guys' theme. Eight notes in low brass with this sort of galloping rhythm behind it. Very dark, grim, threatening music. This is a fully orchestral score. And it deserved to be, it needed to be. But Bernstein did not write individual themes for the characters. When Yul Brynner and Steve McQueen's characters first meet in the town there, you don't hear individual themes for them. In fact, when they both climb on the hearse and start to head up the hill, what you're hearing is a kind of dirge, which comes to a complete stop when they get to the top.
Hold it right there.
Boys, the drink's on me.
And then when it seems that their job is successful, you hear a kind of secondary Magnificent Seven theme, which is a kind of variation on the main title that we heard at the beginning of the picture. It's jubilant, it's joyous, indicating that they've been successful and that these are the guys to look out for. When the six leave for that little Mexican town, Bernstein refers to that sequence as the journey. And that's where we hear the Magnificent Seven theme in all its glory. If you watch closely, you'll see that really the guys are just kind of loping along on the trail. It actually is rather slow moving, but there's immense energy in that music, giving you the illusion that the film is moving more quickly than it actually might be. During that sequence, Chico, the soon-to-be seventh member of the team, is sort of following them. He really wants to be part of it. And so there are moments where we divert to him, and there tends to be guitars in those scenes. But ultimately, when he joins the team, the Magnificent Seven theme returns in all its glory, and it's a really great moment in the film, both musically and visually. Then when they approach the town, I think, the music tends to become a little bit more Mexican in flavor. In fact, I think Bernstein referred to it as Chicano because it contains elements of both American and Mexican colors and flavors. The fiesta music that we hear from time to time in the town certainly sounds authentic. Whether or not he did research to unearth traditional Mexican folk melodies, it's hard to say. A composer's job is always to come up with something that sounds authentic and that, more important than anything, works for the picture. There's not a lot of humor in the picture, but there's a funny sequence where Chico is sort of playing bullfighter with this bull that he spots. There's some pseudo bullfighting music, which is kind of fun. There's a solo trumpet. You really feel like you're in the ring with the bull as you're watching this. But that music takes a very serious turn when Chico realizes that he's being spied upon. And that's his first meeting with Petra. Then a few minutes later, the background music you're hearing, which Bernstein simply called dinner music in his original score, is in fact the music that we then associate with Chico and the girl Petra from then on, as they become kind of romantically involved. And that theme recurs several times later whenever we see those two together. When Calvera's gang returns to town, we naturally hear their theme. And interestingly enough, there's an underpinning of some very aggressive percussion, basically telling us that these boys mean business. But what's interesting about this particular cue is that as they're riding past the little boys outside of town, you begin to realize that the boys are a network that are signaling each other to signal the town that Calvera's gang is coming in. Well, what Bernstein does at that point is to employ an entire battery of percussion so that you're hearing amazing drum patterns, which are a kind of subtle way of saying this is the signaling that's going on. I like that cue a lot because it's more than you might get from the average composer who might simply just play Calvera's theme. This is the mark of an artist at work, I think. Although the picture itself is very serious, the stakes are high for everyone here. There's a surprising amount of buoyant, joyous music throughout the score. For example, often when we're in the town or when we are associated with the townspeople and the farmers, a lot of that music is really kind of lighthearted. And there's a signature tune for Charles Bronson and the little boys who adore and surround him a lot. By and large, though, you're talking about two main themes that service a lot of the picture. As the seven leave the town, having felt that they've been defeated, there's a sequence which Bernstein calls Crossroads. Bernstein's scoring is rather subtle, and a lot of it's under dialogue, but there is a sort of variation on the seven theme at that point. And as they decide, one by one, that they're going to go back and fight in that town, the seven theme returns. This is really the climax of the picture. Bernstein's score helps move us in the same direction emotionally that those guys have decided that they're going to go. In the final long sequence, which is a great battle between Calvera's men and the Seven, there is a kind of back and forth between the main themes, the Calvera gang theme and the Seven theme, depending on who's got the upper hand at the moment and who we're seeing on screen.
Oh God, Chris, I'll get you out of there!
When Harry comes back to try and rescue Chris, the music begins right after Harry is shot. It seems that Calvera's men have the upper hand, so we hear Calvera's gang's theme. Then there's a kind of low-key moment when Chris drags Harry into the building and lies to Harry as he's dying. At that point, we hear a little bit of the Magnificent Seven theme. It's a classic example of scoring action. There's a wonderful moment that occurs right after that when Robert Vaughn's character finds his courage again, bursts into the room and kills some of the outlaws, which then inspires the townspeople to go out and take matters into their own hands. And then, of course, the great moment of irony in which Vaughn's character is killed. Then there's a little bit of dissonance in the music at that point. When Calvera dies, you hear his theme, but Chris doesn't give him the satisfaction of knowing why, in fact, they came back, which, of course, is plaguing Calvera in his dying moments. You hear his theme as he's dying, but then once he's gone, the seventh theme returns, and you know at that point that the seven are going to be triumphant. In the final sequence, when it's time for farewells, and the old man makes a speech about the nature of who they are and what they do, it's marvelously scored, I think mostly with strings. It's a great moment, and it's not something that you're necessarily aware of as you're watching it, but it's a special moment musically, which then, of course, leads to the finale and the sort of brief return of the seventh theme in a very triumphant mode. One of the great things about the Magnificent Seven score is that it's a real original statement. No one had really ever heard music like the Magnificent Seven before this, by a composer who is in complete control of the style and the approach. And I think it became the style to follow for almost everybody thereafter. The only Academy Award nomination the film received was for Elmer Bernstein's music. As the 60s rolled on, that music became famous for another association. The Marlboro cigarette brand licensed the music for its Marlboro Country commercials. Until cigarette commercials were banned from the airwaves in 1971, many kids growing up who didn't know of the film thought that it was the theme for Marlboro cigarettes. It's interesting to me that if the Magnificent Seven had been written as a symphonic statement, a piece for a concert hall, we would revere that today in the same way we revere some of Copland's works. It's that kind of true Americana in style and in harmonies, but also, I think, a vibrant, dynamic work that was unto itself.